So in the previous sessions, it was more to do with the curative model, and now it is to do with what is our scope, our meaning to say social workers' scope in prevention of mental disorders. So even before going into the scope, let's see the actual what exactly is meant by mental ill health refers to the mental health problems, symptoms and disorders. It's just not symptoms, disorders are symptoms, but also how it makes one person dysfunctional at the personal level, social level, as well as occupational level, and how it is disturbing for oneself or others. So when we talk about, for a lay person, when we talk about mental illness, that's what exactly we will explain, rather than talking only in terms of hallucinations and delusions as such. And the other aspect of the presentation, the preventive interventions work by focusing on reducing risk factors and enhancing the protective factors. If you remember in our first presentation, in brief, shortly, we were talking about this risk and protective factors, and that is what elaborately we are going to see in this particular presentation. Okay, so moving on to the need for prevention of mental disorders, you can see it is mental and neurological disorders accounts for 13% of total disability adjusted life years as of now. And by the year 2020, it will account for 15% of the disability, where unipolar depression alone will account for 5.7% of disability adjusted life years. You must be aware of the opposite of disability adjusted life years. It is quality associated life years, that we call it as QALYs. So the problem with mental disorders, it's just not in terms of symptoms. It is also in terms of functioning. Not just functioning, it also has an indirect impact on the economic stigma and discrimination, as well as to some extent premature mortality, the death of persons with mental illness. The problem here is the death is also premature. Till they die, their functioning is also not too optimal. So that's the reason better we prevent, as the famous saying goes, prevention is better than cure. Even that holds good even in this particular mental health aspect. So we have to focus more of prevention and promotion, that too with respect to the field of social work. And when we talk about community mental health, social work, as well as mental illness, we should not forget this public health perspective. It talks about what exactly is meant by prevention. It talks about reducing incidence, reducing prevalence, and reducing the recurrence of mental disorders, time spent with the symptoms or the risk condition for a mental illness, and also preventing or delaying recurrences, and also decreasing the impact of illness in the affected person. When I say impact, it includes not just reduction of symptoms, it is also about that stigma, discrimination, so economic impact, the functioning of the persons, not just the person, also the caregivers in the family. So all these things comes under the word prevention as such, prevention of mental disorders. So before moving into how to prevent, we also need to look into what are all the different levels of prevention. All those people who had done your post-graduation in social work, you would be knowing about this preventive and social medicine by Park and Park, where they would have given in detail about the different levels of prevention. So this different levels of prevention in primary prevention. This primary prevention is basically, the primary prevention aims at reducing the incidence rate. Incident rates is the occurrence of new cases. So that's the main aim of primary prevention. Under that, they talk about three different types of, I'm sure Ilayaraja would be feeling very sleepy. It is 2:30, but I'm sure this points will be helpful for you. I know it's not the right time, but still let's see how best we can make it useful. Universal prevention, it targets the general public. So we don't go for those the persons who are vulnerable. It's for general public, as the example is given there. It's a community awareness programs, or in terms of you know, creating policies, creating programs for general mental health or community, mental illness. So it is not targeted to specific population who are at risk, which is targeted in selective prevention, which is at the next level of primary prevention. You can see it says intervention that targets individuals or subgroups of the population whose risk of developing a mental disorder is significantly higher. For example, as it is given there, a person who is undergoing a chronic pain, you know, for a person with, cancer, they are more vulnerable for mental disorders like depression. Or a person whose parents are having mental illness, the caregiving process itself will make them more vulnerable for mental disorders. So this is the group which we would be focusing under this subgroup of selective prevention. The other one is indicated prevention, which talks about the intervention that targets high-risk people who are identified as having minimal but not symptoms to the level of diagnosis. Already, for example, I have given you there. You can see children in the homes, government homes. They would have already started exhibiting behavioral and emotional problems, which may not be to the level of the diagnosis, but they are more prone than the group which are under that selective prevention group. And also, for example, people who are affected by disasters, people who have some trauma. So they may not have a diagnosable illness, but it is always better to intervene as a preventive strategy even before getting to diagnosable illness as such. So this is to do with primary prevention, which talks about the reduction of incidence of any disorder or incidence of the cases. So this is to do with the primary prevention as such. When it comes to secondary and tertiary prevention, we talk about it lowers the rate of established cases. It's nothing but the prevalence rate. It reduces the prevalence rate. We talk about prevalence rate as the number of persons with that particular illness in a given period of time. Okay, so how I will reduce that prevalence using the secondary prevention? Through early detection and treatment of diagnosable diseases. So this is about secondary prevention. And then tertiary prevention includes interventions that reduces the disability, which means here already there is a well-established diagnosable illness, but how I can prevent that disability further, not reducing the symptoms or alleviating the symptom, which may not be possible. So we would be talking about how I can reduce the disability which is caused by the particular illness. For example, suppose if someone is not actually treated on time for schizophrenia, would be there for some 1 year, 2 year, there we will not be really able to talk about primary prevention and secondary prevention. Here, how I can reduce the disability of that particular patient as well as the family as such, and enhance the rehabilitation and prevent relapses and recurrences of the illnesses. A person with the long-standing substance use problem. So how I can facilitate that particular thing is called about, it's all about the tertiary prevention as such. So this is about different types of prevention, in that primary prevention, secondary prevention and tertiary prevention. Under primary prevention, again, we have three levels of prevention as such. So what is the connection between this and social work? Of course, all these areas has more scope for the social workers as such. We need not keep looking for persons with mental illness. Rather, we can start working on preventing people from getting into mental illness, people or group. And in the first slide, we spoke about risk factors and protective factors. And we all know interventions to prevent mental ill health aim to counteract risk factors and reinforce protective factors, improve the protective factors. If you remember, we just showed this in a slide in the first presentation about what are all, I will show that in the next slide. But before that, the risk factors, what do you mean by risk factors? These are the factors which are associated with an increased probability of onset, greater severity and longer duration of major health and mental health problem, whichever the factors. And when we talk about protective factors, opposite of that is not protective factor. Protective factors, it refers to the conditions that improve people's resistance to risk factors and disorders. You will be more clear in the next slide when we talk about some of the examples of risk factors and protective factors. And lots of studies even now in the past has shown that there is a strong evidence on risk and protective factors and their links to the development of mental disorders as such. Now, few examples from which from where I picked up from the previous presentation. Some of the risk factors you can see, it's not necessarily related to mental health or mental illness. For example, it is more of social in nature and psychological in nature as well, less of biological in nature. Less of biological in nature meaning to say the predisposing factors are called as biological factors, whereas the other risk factors, if you could see, you can see more of child abuse and neglect. Not necessarily abuse, even neglecting a child, they have a more risk of developing mental disorders in the future. Being lonely, not necessarily for a child, anywhere persons being lonely, they have a higher risk of getting into mental disorders. And physically, if you see low birth weight in the beginning, as well as low social class, low socio-economic classes, also they have, because these are not just the points, these are the points derived from various studies which was conducted in the last 2 to 3 decades, as well as to some extent social incompetence. They may be intellectually good, but when they don't have that social incompetence, when they have that social incompetence, then that becomes a higher risk factor for developing mental disorders. When I say mental disorders, it is just not severe mental disorders. It includes minor as well as major mental disorders, and also substance use in general, as well as substance use during pregnancy, has a higher risk of developing mental disorders. And just as a factor which fights against these risk factors are these protective factors. Early cognitive stimulations need not always happen on the in the labs. It can always happen in a natural environment, in the family, in the school, in the place where we are living. Positive parent-child interaction, as well as ability to cope with the stress. The first two will be able to give them the other three factors, like ability to cope, adaptability to the situations, and autonomy. Like, you know, they will be able to work independently. Literacy to some extent. It's not that all persons who are illiterate will have mental disorders, but when you are literate, you that becomes a kind of more protective factors for you to be protected from mental disorders as such. And then the level of self-esteem what we have, and then social support from families and friends, and the physical exercise as such. So these are some of the protective factors, but these are not the exhaustive list. These are some of the examples of protective factors for you to give an idea about how these two interact with each other to protect us or to put us into mental disorders as such. So each and every area become a scope for us. For example, you need not work in a mental health setting. You can just work in a health setting where you are working with children. So when we talk about low birth weight or early cognitive stimulation, that need not happen only in mental health setup. It can happen in a general health setup where you will be focusing on these things basically to prevent these people to get into mental disorders in future. So that kind of care, the reason for care, you should be able to know, so that we will be able to improve the scope of the social work interventions for mental disorders as such. So having given you some examples, let me go in detail about some of the strategies to reduce the risk of mental disorders and improve the quality of life. The nutrition aspect as such. When we are working with children, you must be aware of a lot of government programs which talks about nutrition, free nutrition for the children and all those things. Though it has its own dimensions, one important dimension is the healthy nutrition leads to better cognitive development, improved educational outcomes. When we talk about education, education is one offshoot of the cognitive development. And then the most effective interventions models are those that include food, that is complementary feeding, growth monitoring, and promotion of health, which also includes mental health. See that nutrition and interventions with counseling and psychosocial care. So that this holistic care for the children in any field, not necessarily, again, I reiterate that point, because being certified as a person who has a 3 months diploma in community mental health doesn't mean that you should be only focusing on mental health field. As I told you, it is in different field, this mental health component should be included. For example, you must be knowing a few years before there were a lot of propaganda about this use of iodinized salt. It is basically to prevent, because it helps in the physical as well as development of mental health, physical and mental health. So that's the reason. Otherwise, a lot of studies have shown lack of iodine had led to both physical and mental retardation and impairments in learning disability also in future, which the community may not even know what is the exact cause for this disability as such. So we can easily prevent, as I told you, prevention is better than cure, and prevention is less costlier than curing any illness, especially mental illness, which has lots of indirect cost, economic cost related to treatment of disorders. So this is one area in terms of nutrition. Then housing, what housing has to do with, you know, prevention of mental disorders. We all know how desperate a person who do not have proper housing, both physically and mentally, they will be disturbed, as well as it has been an indicator of poverty and targeted to improve public health and reduce inequalities in health. Our area, our social workers area, though we suppose talk about housing facilities, we also need to understand how these housing facilities leads to improvement in health and mental health. There is also something called as quality of community life, which was developed by there are 33 indicators, quality of community life, which was developed by ICMR. So this 33 questions are something like different indicator. Those indicators also talks about this housing facilities, you know, even in terms of drainage facilities. And you can see last but one line, safe housing facility prevents you from this, you know, crime and social inequalities, which itself will help us to have a better mental health as such. And you all must be knowing, wherever there is a slum kind of area, you can see there's a lot of people who are involved in the crime be part of that. You know, so that's one thing which we need to focus. Don't wait for them to get into antisocial activities or mental disorders with respect to depression or something. When we start working in these areas, focusing on these, for example, housing and even nutrition, next comes the access to education. So these are the areas which we need to work, keeping in mind how it will have an impact in improving the mental health or preventing people from getting into mental disorders. Just they talk about education of women. Just imagine persons who are not educated, how they would even approach the symptoms of mental illness. And people who are educated, how they would even approach the symptoms of mental illness. The pathways of care itself will be different. When I say pathways of care, there will be the people who are not educated, they would be going to the traditional healers. By that time, the treatment gap will prolong. And then there won't be proper cure for it. That is in terms of treating the disorders. But it is also shown that by bringing women together in new social forms that provided them with information about and ideas from wider worlds, that itself will become a catalyst for social change. not all women who are subjected to domestic violence. When it comes to the education part of it, it's not just education about the illness as such. That's the secondary stuff. Whereas here, providing them education, making them literate itself is a strong protective factor for persons to be away from mental disorders as such. And then reducing economic insecurity. Economic insecurity in developing countries, you must be knowing about the farmer suicide. Farmer suicide, we allow that to happen and then we intervene from a curative point of view. So we, again as social workers, have a larger scope when we talk about these people who are into financial crisis, when they don't have a proper plan. Every day we keep looking into the newspaper, we keep getting news of people who are into the financial problem, attempting or committing suicide, and that now more happens in drought-hit areas where farmer suicides are more. So there, that is where, again, as social workers, we need to look into a lot of preventive strategies. Some of the programs like poverty alleviation, targeting credit facilities, gender equity, basic health care, alternate employment, nutrition, education, and human rights issues. So this, again, these are the issues. Though it comes under reducing economic insecurity, as social workers, what is my scope? I would be working on these areas. And again, I'm telling you, these are not, if you see that, it is not directly talking about mental health. But this will lead to prevention of mental disorders and having a positive mental health for any person or the group. Strengthening community networks. When the community, that's what exactly it's told even in district mental health program. One of the main objective of district mental health program is that how I will integrate mental health care into general health care, as well as how I can make the community to participate in providing the care, whether it is preventive or promotive. So that will help us to have a sustained programs. We need not always take it up in a project mode. Once when the community networks are made, once when the communities are made to participate, many community interventions are focused on developing empowering processes and building a sense of ownership. For example, one of the interventions what we do is in collaboration with an organization, NGO, which is called as World Vision India. So they developed their own capacity in a village. These are the social workers who have been trained by NIMHANS, and they would be providing not curative services alone. They would also have sessions with children, women, all these vulnerable groups. Children, women, elderly, substance use, as well as mental disorders. We have given a specific module for them. They would go, and also we had given them the targeted group. So that will come more as a selective intervention and indicative intervention, which comes in the primary prevention. So that is where, even in the absence of institutes like NIMHANS or mental health professionals, lay persons who are trained for some extent can take up these kind of interventions if the community networks are strengthened. So you also, again, let me just, I will focus on the first part of the heading of the presentation, scope of social work. Here, scope of social work is how you are mobilizing these community networks. And if you compare with the other specialities, this is purely a social work specialty where you would be in touch with the community, and also you must be knowing about the community organization, methods of social work, community organization, that comes very close to strengthening the community networks in mental health practice as such. So you always need to relate that particular methods with in the mental health field as. And of course, this is to do with reducing the stressors and enhancing the resilience for people who already have problem or who are about to have problem. This is more to do with the secondary and tertiary prevention as such. You can see there are a lot of evidences for home-based intervention. Home-based interventions for prenatal mothers, prenatal women, home-based interventions for persons with dementia, home-based interventions for persons with long-term mental illness, what we call as home visits, in social work, the same concept of home visit, the objectives would be something very specific to mental disorders as such. And then it also shows such interventions can be cost effective, especially when long-term outcomes are taken into account. The prenatal and infancy home visiting program is an effective example, which is mentioned in many of the literatures. So that need not be only related to women and child. It can be related to disability. It can be related to elderly. It can be related to children as well. And of course, it depends on the resources what we have. If I connect the previous strengthening community network and this point, you can always relate it. When I have this community network, they would be the persons. For example, we have something called as well-being volunteers. So these well-being volunteers would be spread across the city. So if at all, if I want to make home visits, I need not go from a central place like this. I can put them in touch with that particular family, which is happening. They can just spend some time with them, because there will be some families where there is no one to take care of that particular person with mental illness. So they can go and find out once in a week, depending on the availability. So that way, these home-based interventions will be really effective in terms of the improvement of persons. And preschool, educational and parenting intervention. This is again one important thing when we even talk about school mental health program as such. School mental health program, recently we conducted a two-day workshop for the DMHP social workers and psychologists and school mental health program. Before the training, the idea what they had was more in terms of going and identifying persons with mental health problems, which should not be the primary objective. When we talk about the school mental health program, I'm sure you must be remembering what I said in the first presentation. It should be first for the mental well-being of all the students and teachers, and then to the psychosocial problems, and then finding out mental disorders among these children. When we talk about mental disorders, it is more to do with intellectual problems, that is developmental disorders, emotional disorders, as well as behavioral problems. In the beginning, you cannot just go and talk only about the disorders as such. As we keep providing this preventional program, we will be easily able to identify those children who require that extra attention as such. So it should be more of a universal preschool program where we talk about health screening. Health screening, it also includes mental health screening for developmental disorders, recreation and television program, reading skills, and then social and emotional values. So from the beginning, like a syllabus, if this mental health aspects are added, it will definitely, it's not me who's saying, it's the literature which says, it definitely reduces the incidence of mental disorders. Incidence of mental disorders like depression, anxiety, of course not schizophrenia, but anxiety, depression or like minor mental disorders. And of course, parent, because they are one of the most important, parent as well as teachers. I did not mention there. Parent as well as teacher form a very important component in that socialization process of children. So they also have to be spoken about positive parenting or parent management programs, either through you or through the teachers. So when it is through teachers, that will also improve the bonding between teachers and the parents. So to begin with, again, when I come to scope of social work, you need not look at, is it possible? You can see how it is possible by implementing it in one or two schools. When we talk about model programs, wherever you are working. So accordingly, you can enlarge that particular program to other schools by seeing the effectiveness. And another issue with regard to mental illness is that coping with mental illness in the family, especially children whose parents are mentally ill. So it is always better to address those issues before the family members get into. For example, there are a lot of family members whose family member is having schizophrenia. Their caregivers tend to have depression. Persons who have dementia, their caregivers tend to have depression or anxiety. You know, so that is all. We need not reinvent the wheels. So when you as social workers thinking about interventions, also include this component. Educate them. How to, what are the strategies we will see later. But these are some of the issues we need to think when we talk about reducing the stresses and enhancing the resilience. And of course, the other one is related to the family disruption. It may not come, it will never, it may not come to the maximum time, it will not come to the level of mental disorders. But still, there will be a lot of psychological problems as such. So, parental death, divorce, or even marital issues between husband and wife, it will have an impact on both husband and wife, as well as on the children and other family members. So here again, there is a scope for social work to talk about marital and family counseling, even if they do not have any diagnosable mental disorders as such. If this is not given, then they have more chances of getting into diagnosable mental disorders as such. Okay, so this is one area. So to specific mental disorders, if you remember in the first slide, I have shown a document about prevention of mental disorders. There they have given these areas, but I've just tried to put it in a table. This is not in this format. Just for our easy understanding, I have tried to put it in this way. So, specific mental disorders, what do you mean by universal intervention? What do you mean by selective intervention? And what do you mean intervention? I'm not going to read all the things, just to take an example of conduct disorder. So, universal intervention, I am not going to identify who has a conduct problem. But in general, there will be behavioral management programs in the schools. There will be social skills programs. There will be child development programs. Okay, so that you can do it. And then in selective intervention, in the process of universal intervention, we can find out the mother, prenatal women and early childhood programs we can initiate for that particular group. Selective group. Whereas if you see indicated intervention for the children who have already been identified by teachers and parents as having some behavioral or emotional problems. So which means it requires more intervention compared to the more specific intervention compared to the universal and selective intervention. So as social workers, we need to find out which is the group who falls under which type of primary or secondary, or this is in terms of primary interventions as such. And then school-based programs targeting cognitive problem solving and social skills, this is more to do with depression. Okay, and similarly, anxiety disorders, substance-related disorders, even in primary prevention, these are all the things what we are talking about. For example, you see in substance-related disorders, you can see effective regulatory interventions such as taxations, media interventions. For example, in India, there will be no direct advertisements for tobacco and alcohol. Of course, they advertise it in different manner, soda and, you know, ilachi and all those stuff. But you cannot really see direct advertisements on alcohol and tobacco. So that is more to do with universal prevention. That is the interventions. The same thing, individual and family counseling for those who are just into this problem. That is the selective intervention, even in the primary intervention. And then the indicated intervention is for those people who have been identified as having problem, which can even be done at the general practitioner level. So this is at the primary intervention, what are all the different levels of interventions, what we are. There is also secondary and tertiary interventions, which will be taken by secondary and tertiary prevention, which will be taken care by the mental health professionals as such. Whereas these things can be done by trained social workers, trained professionals who are not actually mental health professionals as such. So this is to do with specific mental disorders. And then when it comes to suicide as such, yes, you all will be aware of hotlines and crisis centers. School-based programs in terms of what are all the various alternative strategies for suicide, and then gatekeeper training programs. Now we train a lot of these lay counselors on how to keep a watch on these high-risk people and what are the first aid, psychological first aid, what you can do. So these are the things which we can initiate as social workers, which also would result in early identification and interventions in primary care, and at the larger level, trying to advocate for reducing the access to the means to commit suicide. For example, even now, the benzodiazepines, that sleeping tablets, will not be available across the counter. You need to have prescriptions. You know, something like that, if we are able to reduce those means, that itself will reduce the. That's the reason if you see the lethality between male and female, the lethality will be more among male compared to female, because the access for that, such kind of means, is much lesser to women compared to men. And that's the reason even the successful suicidal rates will be less compared to less in women compared to men. Okay, so though the number of women are more in attempting suicide, the successful attempt of suicide will be found more in men, because one reason could be easy access of means for the committing suicide as such. Okay, so these are all some of the areas where we have a definite scope in prevention of mental disorders. And to conclude, the distinction between mental health promotion and prevention lies in the targeted outcomes. For example, one example would be like, suppose if I do life skills education program in a normal school, then it becomes promotion of mental health. Suppose if I do the same life skills education program for children who are on the streets, who are in an organization. Okay, so what does it mean? There it is not for not just for promotion of mental health, it is also to prevent them from substance use. It is also to use those skills from preventing them from the mental disorders as such. So it is not about what is that you are doing, for whom you are doing it, it matters. And also in that context, we can even say prevention of mental disorder, whatever strategy, it can be considered as one of the aims and outcomes of a broader mental health promotion strategy. Like there is no hard and fast rules or compartment between promotion and prevention. If you see, a primary prevention will be more to do with the promotion as such. And again, it depends on the targeted groups whom we are looking at. So in that way, I would conclude this presentation. But then the next interactive session, we would be talking more in terms of how do we promote mental health among different people and what are the different strategies as such. So with this, I'll stop here my presentation on prevention of mental disorders.